Tantor Audio, a division of Recorded Books, presents More Than Human by Theodore Sturgeon. Narrated by Preston Geer. 1. The Fabulous Idiot. The idiot lived in a black and gray world, punctuated by the white lightning of hunger and the flickering of fear. His clothes were old and many-windowed. Here peeped a shinbone, sharp as a cold chisel, and there, in the torn coat, were ribs like the fingers of a fist. He was tall and flat. His eyes were calm, and his face was dead. Men turned away from him. Women would not look. Children stopped and watched him. It did not seem to matter to the idiot. He expected nothing from any of them. When the white lightning struck, he was fed. He fed himself when he could. He went without when he could. When he could do neither of these things, he was fed by the first person who came face to face with him. The idiot never knew why, and never wondered. He did not beg. He would simply stand and wait. When someone met his eyes, there would be a coin in his hand, a piece of bread, a fruit. He would eat, and his benefactor would hurry away, disturbed, not understanding. Sometimes, nervously, they would speak to him. They would speak about him to each other. The idiot heard the sounds, but they had no meaning for him. He lived inside somewhere, apart, and the little link between word and significance hung broken. His eyes were excellent, and could readily distinguish between a smile and a snarl, but neither could have any impact on a creature so lacking in sympathy, who himself had never laughed and never snarled, and so could not comprehend the feelings of his gay or angry fellows. He had exactly enough fear to keep his bones together and oiled. He was incapable of anticipating anything. The stick that raised, the stone that flew, found him unaware. But at their touch, he would respond. He would escape. He would start to escape at the first blow, and he would keep on trying to escape until the blows ceased. He escaped storms this way, rockfalls, men, dogs, traffic, and hunger. He had no preferences. It happened that where he was, there was more wilderness than town. Since he lived wherever he found himself, he lived more in the forest than anywhere else. They had locked him up 4 times. It had not mattered to him any of the times, nor had it changed him in any way. Once, he had been badly beaten by an inmate, and once, even worse, by a guard. In the other 2 places, there had been the hunger. When there was food, and he was left to himself, he stayed. When it was time for escape, he escaped. The means to escape were in his outer husk. The inner thing that it carried either did not care or could not command. But when the time came, a guard or a warden would find himself face to face with the idiot, and the idiot's eyes, whose irises seemed on the trembling point of spinning like wheels. The gate would open, and the idiot would go, and as always, the benefactor would run to do something else, anything else, deeply troubled. He was purely animal, a degrading thing to be among men, but most of the time, he was an animal away from men. As an animal in the woods, he moved like an animal, beautifully. He killed like an animal, without hate and without joy. He ate like an animal, everything edible he could find, and he ate, when he could, only enough and never more. He slept like an animal, well and lightly, faced in the opposite direction from that of a man. For a man going to sleep is about to escape into it, while animals are prepared to escape out of it. He had an animal's maturity, in which the play of kittens and puppies no longer has a function. He was without humor and without joy. His spectrum lay between terror and contentment. He was 25 years old. Like a stone in a peach, a yolk in an egg, he carried another thing. It was passive. It was receptive. It was awake and alive. If it was connected in any way to the animal integument, it ignored the connections. It drew its substance from the idiot and was otherwise unaware of him. He was often hungry, but he rarely starved. When he did starve, the inner thing shrank a little, perhaps, but it hardly noticed its own shrinking. It must die when the idiot died, but it contained no motivation to delay that event by 1 second. It had no function specific to the idiot. A spleen, a kidney, an adrenal, these have definite functions and an optimum level for those functions. But this was a thing which only received and recorded. It did this without words, without a code system of any kind, without translation, without distortion, and without operable outgoing conduits. It took what it took and gave out nothing. All around it, to its special senses, was a murmur, ascending. It soaked itself in the murmur, absorbed it as it came, all of it. Perhaps it matched and classified, or perhaps it simply fed, taking what it needed and discarding the rest in some intangible way. The idiot was unaware. The thing inside. Without words.
"Warm when the wet comes for a little, but not enough for long enough."
Sadly.
"Never dark again."
A feeling of pleasure. A sense of subtle crushing and...
"Take away the pink, the scratchy. Wait, wait, you can go back. Yes, you can go back. Different, but almost as good."
Sleep feelings.
"Yes, that's it. That's the... Oh!"
Alarm.
"You've gone too far. Come back. Come back. Come."
A twisting... A sudden cessation, and one less voice.
"It all rushes up. Faster, faster. Carrying me."
Answer.
"No, no. Nothing rushes. It's still... Something pulls you down onto it. That's all."
Fury.
"They don't hear us. Stupid, stupid." "They do. They don't. Only crying. Only noises."
Without words, though. Impression, depression, dialogue. Radiations of fear. Tense fields of awareness, discontent. Murmuring, sending, speaking, sharing. From hundreds, from thousands of voices. None, though. For the idiot. Nothing that related to him. Nothing he could use. He was unaware of his inner ear because it was useless to him. He was a poor example of a man, but he was a man. And these were the voices of the children, the very young children, who had not yet learned to stop crying to be heard.
"Only crying. Only noises."
Mr. Q was a good father, the very best of fathers. He told his daughter Alicia so on her 19th birthday. He had said as much to Alicia ever since she was 4. She was 4 when little Evelyn had been born, and their mother had died cursing him, her indignation at last awake and greater than her agony and her fear. Only a good father, the very finest of fathers, could have delivered his second child with his own hands. No ordinary father could have nursed and nurtured the two, the baby and the infant, so tenderly and so well. No child was ever so protected from evil as Alicia, and when she joined forces with her father, a mighty structure of purity was created for Evelyn. "Purity triple distilled," Mr. Q said to Alicia on her 19th birthday. "I know good through the study of evil, and have taught you only the good. And that good teaching has become your good living, and your way of life is Evelyn's star. I know all the evil there is, and you know all the evil which must be avoided. But Evelyn knows no evil at all." At 19, of course, Alicia was mature enough to understand these abstracts, this way of life and distillation, and the inclusive good and evil. When she was 16, he had explained to her how a man went mad if he was alone with a woman, and how the poison sweat appeared on his body, and how he would put it on her, and then it would cause the horror on her skin. He had pictures of skin like that in his books. When she was 13, she had a trouble, and told her father about it, and he told her, with tears in his eyes, that this was because she had been thinking about her body, as indeed she had been. She confessed it, and he punished her body until she wished she had never owned one. And she tried. She tried not to think like that again, but she did, in spite of herself. And regularly, regretfully, her father helped her in her efforts to discipline her intrusive flesh. When she was 8, he taught her how to bathe in darkness, so she would be spared the blindness of those white eyes of which he also had magnificent pictures. And when she was 6, he had hung in her bedroom the picture of a woman called Angel and the picture of a man called Devil. The woman held her palms up and smiled, and the man had his arms out to her, his hands like hooks, and protruding point outward from his breastbone was a crooked knife blade with a wetness on it. They lived alone in a heavy house on a wooded knoll. There was no driveway, but a path which turned and turned again, so that from the windows no one could see where it went. It went to a wall, and in the wall was an iron gate, which had not been opened in 18 years, and beside the gate was a steel panel. Once a day, Alicia's father went down the path to the wall, and with 2 keys opened the 2 locks in the panel. He would swing it up and take out food and letters, put money and mail in, and lock it again. There was a narrow road outside which Alicia and Evelyn had never seen. The woods concealed the wall, and the wall concealed the road. The wall ran by the road for 200 yards, east and west. It mounted the hill then until it bracketed the house. Here it met iron pickets, 15 feet high and so close together a man could hardly press a fist between them. The tops of the pickets curved out and down, and between them was cement, and in the cement was broken glass. The pickets ran east and west, connecting the house to the wall, and where they joined, more pickets ran back and back into the woods in a circle. The wall and the house, then, were a rectangle, and that was forbidden territory. And behind the house were the 2 square miles of fenced woodland, and that belonged to Evelyn, with Alicia to watch. There was a brook there, wild flowers and a little pond, friendly oaks and little hidden glades. The sky above was fresh and near, and the pickets could not be seen for the shouldering masses of holly which grew next to them, all the way around, blocking the view, breaking the breeze. This closed circle was all the world to Evelyn, all the world she knew, and all in the world she loved lay in it. On Alicia's 19th birthday, Evelyn was alone by her pond. She could not see the house, She could not see the holly hedge nor the pickets, but the sky was there, up and up, and the water was there, by and by. Alicia was in the library with her father. On birthdays, he always had special things planned for Alicia in the library. Evelyn had never been in the library. The library was a place where her father lived and where Alicia went at special times. Evelyn never thought of going there, any more than she thought of breathing water like a speckled trout. She had not been taught to read, but only to listen and obey. She had never learned to seek, but only to accept. Knowledge was given to her when she was ready for it, and only her father and sister knew just when that might be. She sat on the bank, smoothing her long skirts. She saw her ankle and gasped and covered it as Alicia would do if she were here. She set her back against a willow trunk and watched the water. It was spring, the part of spring where the bursting is done. The held-in pressures of desiccated sap veins and gum-sealed buds are gone, and all the world's in a rush to be beautiful. The air was heavy and sweet. It lay upon lips until they parted, pressed them until they smiled, entered boldly to beat in the throat like a second heart. It was air with a puzzle to it, for it was still and full of the colors of dreams. All motionless, yet it had a hurry to it. The stillness and the hurry were alive and laced together, and how could that be? That was the puzzle. A dazzle of bird notes stitched through the green. Evelyn's eyes stung and wonder misted the wood. Something tensed in her lap. She looked down in time to see her hands attack one another, and off came her long gloves. Her naked hands fled to the sides of her neck, not to hide something, but to share something. She bent her head, and the hands laughed at one another under the iron order of her hair. They found four hooks and scampered down them. Her high collar eased, and the enchanted air rushed in with a soundless shout. Evelyn breathed as if she had been running. She put out her hand hesitantly, futilely, patted the grass beside her as if somehow the act might release the inexpressible confusion of delight within her. It would not, and she turned and flung herself face down in a bed of early mint and wept because the spring was too beautiful to be born. He was in the wood, numbly prying the bark from a dead oak, when it happened. His hands were still, and his head came up hunting, harking. He was as aware of the pressures of spring as an animal, and slightly more than an animal could be. But abruptly, the spring was more than heavy, hopeful air, and the shifting of earth with life. A hard hand on his shoulder could have been no more tangible than this call. He rose carefully, as if something around him might break if he were clumsy. His strange eyes glowed. He began to move. He, who had never called, nor been called, nor responded before. He moved toward the thing he sensed, and it was a matter of will, not of external compulsion. Without analysis, he was aware of the bursting within him of an insistent need. It had been a part of him all his life, but there was no hope in him that he might express it. And bursting so, it flung a thread across his internal gulf, linking his alive and independent core to the half-dead animal around it. It was ascending straight to what was human in him, received by an instrument which, up to now, had accepted only the incomprehensible radiations of the newborn, and so had been ignored. But now it spoke, as it were, in his own tongue. He was careful and swift, careful and silent. He turned his wide shoulders to one side and the other as he moved, slipping through the alders, passing the pines closely as if it were intolerable to leave the direct line between himself and his call. The sun was high. The woods were homogeneously the woods, front, right, left, yet he followed his course without swerving, not from knowledge, not by any compass, but purely in conscious response. He arrived suddenly, for the clearing was, in the forest, a sudden thing. For 50 feet outward, the earth around the close-set pickets had been leached, and all trees felled years ago, so that none might overhang the fence. The idiot slipped out of the wood and trotted across the bare ground to the serried iron. He put out his arms as he ran, slid his hands between the pickets, and when they caught on his starved, bony forearms, his legs kept moving, his feet sliding, as if his need empowered him to walk through the fence and the impenetrable holly beyond it. The fact that the barrier would not yield came to him slowly. It was as if his feet understood it first and stopped trying, and then his hands, which withdrew. His eyes, however, would not give up at all. From his dead face they yearned through the iron, through the holly, ready to burst with answering. His mouth opened, and a scratching sound emerged. He had never tried to speak before, and could not now. The gesture was an end, not a means, like the starting of tears at a crescendo of music. He began to move along the fence, walking sideways, finding it unbearable to turn away from the call. It rained for a day and a night, and for half the next day, and when the sun came out, it rained again, upward. It rained a light from the heavy jewels which lay on the rich new green. Some jewels shrank, and some fell, and then the earth in a voice of softness, and leaves in a voice of texture, and flowers speaking in color, were grateful. Evelyn crouched on the window seat, elbows on the sill, her hands cupped to the curves of her cheeks, their pressure making it easy to smile. Softly, she sang. It was strange to hear, for she did not know music. She did not read and had never been told of music. But there were birds. There was the bassoon of wind in the eaves sometimes. There were the calls and cooings of small creatures in that part of the wood which was hers and, distantly, from the part which was not. Her singing was made of these things, with strange and effortless fluctuations in pitch, from an instrument unbound by the diatonic scale, freely phrased.
But I never touch the gladness, may not touch the gladness. Beauty, oh beauty of touchness, spread like a leaf, nothing between me and the sky but light. Rain touches me, wind touches me, leaves, other leaves, touch and touch me.
She made music without words for a long moment and was silent, making music without sound, watching the raindrops fall in the glowing noon. Harshly,
"What are you doing?"
Evelyn started and turned. Alicia stood behind her, her face strangely tight.
"What are you doing?" she repeated.
Evelyn made a vague gesture toward the window, tried to speak.
"Well?"
Evelyn made the gesture again.
"Out there," she said. I...
She slipped off the window seat and stood. She stood as tall as she could. Her face was hot.
"Button up your collar," said Alicia.
"What is it, Evelyn? Tell me." "I'm trying to," said Evelyn, soft and urgent.
She buttoned her collar, and her hands fell to her waist. She pressed herself, hard. Alicia stepped near and pushed the hands away.
Don't do that. What was that? What you were doing? Were you talking? Talking, yes. Not you, though. Not Father. There isn't anyone else. There is, said Evelyn.
Suddenly breathless, she said,
Touch me, Alicia.
Touch you?
Yes, I want you to. Just...
She held out her arms. Alicia backed away.
We don't touch one another,
she said, as gently as she could through her shock.
What is it, Evelyn? Aren't you well? Yes, said Evelyn. No, I don't know.
She turned to the window.
It isn't raining. It's dark here. There's so much sun. So much. I want the sun on me, like a bath, warm all over.
Silly. Then it would be all light in your bath. We don't talk about bathing, dear.
Evelyn picked up a cushion from the window seat. She put her arms around it, and with all her strength hugged it to her breast.
Evelyn, stop that!
Evelyn whirled and looked at her sister in a way she had never used before. Her mouth twisted. She squeezed her eyes tight closed, and when she opened them, tears fell.
I want to, she cried. I want to! Evelyn,
Alicia whispered. Wide-eyed, she backed away to the door.
I shall have to tell Father.
Evelyn nodded and drew her arms even tighter around the cushion. When he came to the brook, the idiot squatted down beside it and stared. A leaf danced past, stopped, and curtsied, then made its way through the pickets and disappeared in the low gap the holly had made for it. He had never thought deductively before, and perhaps his effort to follow the leaf was not thought-born. Yet he did, only to find that the pickets were set in a concrete channel here. They combed the water from one side to the other. Nothing larger than a twig or a leaf could slip through. He wallowed in the water, pressing against the iron, beating at the submerged cement. He swallowed water and choked and kept trying, blindly, insistently. He put both his hands on one of the pickets and shook it. It tore his palm. He tried another and another, and suddenly one rattled against the lower crossmember. It was a different result from that of any other attack. It is doubtful whether he realized that this difference meant that the iron here had rusted and was therefore weaker. It simply gave hope because it was different. He sat down on the bottom of the brook and in water up to his armpits. He placed a foot on each side of the picket which had rattled. He got his hands on it again, took a deep breath, and pulled with all his strength. A stain of red rose in the water and whirled downstream. He leaned forward, then back with a tremendous jerk. The rusted underwater segment snapped. He hurtled backward, striking his head stingingly on the edge of the channel. He went limp for a moment, and his body half rolled, half floated back to the pickets. He inhaled water, coughed painfully, and raised his head. When the spinning world righted itself, he fumbled under the water. He found an opening a foot high, but only about 7 inches wide. He put his arm in it, right up to the shoulder, his head submerged. He sat up again and put a leg into it. Again, he was dimly aware of the inexorable fact that will alone was not enough, that pressure alone upon the barrier would not make it yield. He moved to the next picket and tried to break it as he had the one before. It would not move, nor would the one on the other side. At last, he rested. He looked up hopelessly at the 15-foot top of the fence with its close-set, out-curving fangs and its hungry rows of broken glass. Something hurt him. He moved and fumbled and found himself with the 11-inch piece of iron he had broken away. He sat with it in his hands, staring stupidly at the fence.
Touch me. Touch me.
It was that, and a great swelling of emotion behind it. It was a hunger, a demand, a flood of sweetness and of need. The call had never ceased, but this was something different. It was as if the call were a carrier and this a signal suddenly impressed upon it. When it happened, that thread within him, bridging his two selves, trembled and swelled. Falteringly, it began to conduct. Fragments and flickerings of inner power shot across, were laden with awareness and information, shot back. The strange eyes fell to the piece of iron. The hands turned it. His reason itself ached with disuse as it stirred. Then, for the first time, came into play on such a problem. He sat in the water, close by the fence, and with the piece of iron, he began to rub against the picket just under the crossmember. It began to rain. It rained all day and all night and half the next day.
"She was here,"
said Alicia. Her face was flushed. Mr. Q circled the room, his deep-set eyes alight. He ran his whip through his fingers. There were four lashes. Alicia said, remembering,
"And she wanted me to touch her. She asked me to."
"She'll be touched," he said. "Evil. Evil," he muttered. "Evil can't be filtered out," he chanted. "I thought it could. I thought it could. You're evil, Alicia, as you know, because a woman touched you. For years she handled you, but not Evelyn. It's in the blood, and the blood must be let. Where is she, do you think?"
"Perhaps outdoors. The pool. That will be it. She likes the pool. I'll go with you."
He looked at her, her hot face, bright eyes.
"This is for me to do. Stay here."
"Please."
He whirled the heavy-handled whip.
"You too, Alicia?"
She half turned from him, biting into a huge excitement.
"Later,"
he growled. He ran out. Alicia stood a moment trembling, then plunged to the window. She saw her father outside, striding purposely away. Her hands spread and curled against the sash. Her lips writhed apart, and she uttered a strange, wordless bleat. When Evelyn reached the pool, she was out of breath. Something, an invisible smoke, a magic, lay over the water. She took it in hungrily, and was filled with a sense of nearness. Whether it was a thing which was near or an event, she did not know. But it was near, and she welcomed it. Her nostrils arched and trembled. She ran to the water's edge and reached out toward it. There was a boiling in the upstream end, and up from under the holly stems he came. He thrashed to the bank and lay there gasping, looking up at her. He was wide and flat, covered with scratches. His hands were puffy and water-wrinkled. He was gaunt and worn. Shreds of clothing clung to him here and there, covering him not at all. She leaned over him, spellbound, and from her came the call. Floods of it. Loneliness and expectancy and hunger, gladness and sympathy. There was a great amazement in her, but no shock and no surprise. She had been aware of him for days, and he of her, and now their silent radiations reached out to each other, mixed and mingled and meshed. Silently, they lived in each other, and then she bent and touched him, touched his face and shaggy hair. He trembled violently and kicked his way up out of the water. She sank down beside him. They sat close together, and at last she met those eyes. The eyes seemed to swell up and fill the air. She wept for joy and sank forward into them, wanting to live there, perhaps to die there, but at very least to be a part of them. She had never spoken to a man, and he had never spoken to anyone. She did not know what a kiss was, and any he might have seen had no significance to him. But they had a better thing. They stayed close, one of her hands on his bare shoulder, and the currents of their inner selves surged between them. They did not hear her father's resolute footsteps, nor his gasp, nor his terrible bellow of outrage. They were aware of nothing but each other until he leapt on them, caught her up, lifted her high, threw her behind him. He did not look to see where or how she struck the ground. He stood over the idiot, his lips white, his eyes staring. His lips parted, and again he made the terrible sound. And then he lifted the whip. So dazed was the idiot that the first multiple blow and the second seemed not to affect him at all, though his flesh, already soaked and cut and beaten, split and spouted. He lay staring dully at that mid-air point which had contained Evelyn's eyes and did not move. Then the lashes whistled and clacked, and buried their braided tips in his back again, and the old reflex returned to him. He pressed himself backward, trying to slide feet first into the water. The man dropped his whip and caught the idiot's bony wrist in both his hands. He literally ran a dozen steps up the bank, the idiot's long, tattered body flailing along behind him. He kicked the creature's head, ran back for his whip. When he returned with it, the idiot had managed to rear up on his elbows. The man kicked him again, rolled him over on his back. He put one foot on the idiot's shoulder and pinned him down and slashed at the naked belly with the whip. There was a devil's shriek behind him, and it was as if a bullock with tiger's claws had attacked him. He fell heavily and twisted, to look up into the crazed face of his younger daughter. She had bitten her lips, and she drooled and bled. She clawed at his face. One of her fingers slipped into his left eye. He screamed in agony, sat up, twined his fingers in the complexity of lace at her throat, and clubbed her twice with the loaded whip handle. Blubbering, whining, he turned to the idiot again. But now the implacable demands of escape had risen, flushing away everything else. And perhaps another thing was broken as the whip handle crushed the consciousness from the girl. In any case, there was nothing left but escape, and there could be nothing else until it was achieved. The long body flexed like a snap beetle, flung itself up and over in a half somersault. The idiot struck the bank on all fours and sprang as he struck. The lash caught him in midair, his flying body curled around it, for a brief instant capturing the lashes between the lower ribs and the hip bone. The handle slipped from the man's grasp. He screamed and dove after the idiot, who plunged into the arch at the holly roots. The man's face buried itself in the leaves and tore. He sank and surged forward again in the water. With one hand, he caught a naked foot. It kicked him on the ear as he pulled it toward him, and then the man's head struck the iron pickets. The idiot was under and through already, and lay half out of the brook, twitching feebly in an exhausted effort to bring his broken body to its feet. He turned to look back and saw the man clinging to the bars, raging, not understanding about the underwater gap in the fence. The idiot clung to the earth, pink, bloody water swirling away from him and down on his pursuer. Slowly, the escape reflex left him. There was a period of blankness, and then a strange new feeling came to him. It was as new an experience as the call which had brought him here, and very nearly as strong. It was a feeling like fear, but where fear was a fog to him, clammy and blinding, this was something with a thirsty edge to it, hard and purposeful. He relaxed his grasp on the poisoned weeds which grew sickly in the leached ground by the brook. He let the water help him and drifted down again to the bars, where the insane father mouthed and yammered at him. He brought his dead face close to the fence and widened his eyes. The screaming stopped. For the first time, he used the eyes consciously, purposely, for something other than a crust of bread. When the man was gone, he dragged himself out of the brook and, faltering, crawling toward the woods. When Alicia saw her father returning, she put the heel of her hand in her mouth and bit down until her teeth met. It was not his clothes, wet and torn, nor even his ruined eye. It was something else. Something which...
Father!
He did not answer, but strode up to her. At the last possible instant before being walked down like a wheat stalk, she numbly stepped aside. He stamped past her and through the library doors, leaving them open.
Father!
No answer. She ran to the library. He was across the room, at the cabinets which she had never seen open. One was open now. From it he took a long-barreled target revolver and a small box of cartridges. This he opened, spilling the cartridges across his desk. Methodically, he began to load. Alicia ran to him.
What is it? What is it? You're hurt. Let me help you. What are you...
His one good eye was fixed and glassy. He breathed slowly, too deeply, the air rushing in for too long, being held for too long, whistling out and out. He snapped the cylinder into place, clicked off the safety, looked at her, and raised the gun. She was never to forget that look. Terrible things happened then and later, but time softened the focus, elided the details. But that look was to be with her forever. He fixed the one eye on her, caught and held her with it. She squirmed on it like an impaled insect. She knew with a horrifying certainty that he did not see her at all, but looked at some unknowable horror of his own. Still looking through her, he put the muzzle of the gun in his mouth and pulled the trigger. There was not much noise. His hair fluffed upward on top. The eye still stared. She was still pierced by it. She screamed his name. He was no less reachable dead than he had been a moment before. He bent forward, as if to show her the ruin which had replaced his hair and the thing that held her broke, and she ran. 2 hours. 2 whole hours passed before she found Evelyn. One of the hours was simply lost. It was a blackness and a pain. The other was too quiet. A time of wandering about the house, followed by a soft little whimpering that she made herself.
What?
She whimpered.
What's that you say?
Trying to understand. Asking and asking the quiet house for the second hour. She found Evelyn by the pool, lying on her back with her eyes wide open. On the side of Evelyn's head was a puffiness, and in the center of the puffiness was a hollow into which she could have laid three fingers.
"Don't,"
said Evelyn softly when Alicia tried to lift her head. Alicia set it back gently and knelt and took her hands and squeezed them together.
"Evelyn, oh, what happened?" "Father hit me,"
Evelyn said calmly.
"I'm going to go to sleep."
Alicia whimpered. Evelyn said,
"What is it called when a person needs a person, when you want to be touched, and the two are like one thing, and there isn't anything else at all anywhere?"
Alicia, who had read books, thought about it.
"Love,"
she said at length. She swallowed.
"It's a madness. It's bad."
Evelyn's quiet face was suffused with a kind of wisdom.
"It isn't bad,"
she said.
"I had it." "You have to get back to the house." "I'll sleep here," said Evelyn.
She looked up at her sister and smiled.
"It's all right." "Alicia?" "Yes." "I won't ever wake up,"
she said with that strange wisdom.
"I wanted to do something, and now I can't. Will you do it for me?" "I'll do it,"
Alicia whispered.
"For me,"
Evelyn insisted.
"You won't want to." "I'll do it." "When the sun is bright,"
Evelyn said,
"take a bath in it. There's more. Wait."
She closed her eyes. A little furrow came and went on her brow.
"Be in the sun like that. Move. Run. Run and jump high. Make a wind and running and moving. I so wanted that. I didn't know until now that I wanted it, and now I... Oh, Alicia." "What is it? What is it?" "There it is. There it is. Can't you see? The love with the sun on its body."
The soft, wise eyes were wide, looking at the darkling sky. Alicia looked up and saw nothing. When she looked down again, she knew that Evelyn was also seeing nothing. Not anymore. Far off, in the woods beyond the fence, there was a rush of weeping. Alicia stayed there listening to it, and at last put out her hand and closed Evelyn's eyes. She rose and went toward the house, and the weeping followed her and followed her, almost until she reached the door, and even then it seemed to go on inside her. When Mrs. Prod heard the hoof thuds in the yard, she muttered under her breath and peered out between the dimity kitchen curtains. By a combination of starlight and deep familiarity with the yard itself, she discerned the horse and stone boat, with her husband plodding beside it, coming through the gate. "He'll get what for," she mumbled. "Off to the woods so long and letting her burn dinner." He didn't get what for, though. One look at his broad face precluded it.
"What is it, Prod?"
she asked, alarmed.
"Give me a blanket."
"Why on earth?
Hurry now. Feller bad hurt. Picked him up in the woods. Looks like a bear chewed him. Got the clothes ripped off him."
She brought the blanket, running, and he snatched it and went out. In a moment, he was back, carrying a man.
"Here,"
said Mrs. Prod. She flung open the door to Jack's room. When Prod hesitated, the long, limp body dangling in his arms, she said.
Go on, go on. Never mind the spread. It'll wash.
Get a rag. Hot water,
he grunted. She went out, and he gently lifted off the blanket.
Oh my God.
He stopped her at the door.
He won't last the night. Maybe we shouldn't plague him with that.
He indicated the steaming basin she carried.
We got to try.
She went in. She stopped, and he deftly took the basin from her as she stood, white-faced, her eyes closed.
Ma?
Come,
she said softly. She went to the bed and began to clean the tattered body. He lasted the night. He lasted the week, too, and it was only then that the prods began to have hope for him. He lay motionless in the room called Jack's room, interested in nothing, aware of nothing except perhaps the light as it came and went at the window. He would stare out as he lay, perhaps seeing, perhaps watching, perhaps not. There was little to be seen out there. A distant mountain, a few of Prod's sparse acres, occasionally Prod himself, a doll in the distance, scratching the stubborn soil with a broken harrow, stooping for weed shoots. His inner self was insistent and silent in sorrow. His outer self seemed shrunken, unreachable also. When Mrs. Prod brought food, eggs and warm sweet milk, home-cured ham and Johnny cake, he would eat if she urged him, ignore both her and the food if she did not. In the evenings,
"He say anything yet?"
Prod would ask, and his wife would shake her head. After 10 days, he had a thought. After 2 weeks, he voiced it.
"You don't suppose he's touched, do you, Ma?"
She was unaccountably angry.
"How do you mean, touched?"
He gestured.
"You know, like feeble-minded. I mean, maybe he don't talk because he can't."
"No,"
she said positively. She looked up to see the question in Prod's face. She said,
"You ever look in his eyes? He's no idiot."
He had noticed the eyes. They disturbed him. That was all he could say of them.
"Well, I wish he'd say something."
She touched a thick coffee cup.
"You know Grace."
"Well, you told me. Your cousin that lost her little ones."
"Yes. Well, after the fire, Grace was almost like that, lying quiet all day. Talk to her, it was like she didn't hear. Show her something, she might have been blind. Had to spoon-feed her, wash her face."
"Maybe it's that, then," he allowed. "That feller, he sure walked into something worth forgetting up there. Grace, she got better, didn't she?"
"Well, she was never the same," said his wife. "But she got over it. I guess sometimes the world's too much to live with, and a body sort of has to turn away from it to rest."
The weeks went by, and broken tissues knit, and the wide, flat body soaked up nourishment like a cactus absorbing moisture. Never in his life had he had rest and food, and... She sat with him, talked to him. She sang songs, "Flow Gently, Sweet Afton," and "Home on the Range." She was a little brown woman with colorless hair and bleached eyes, and there was about her a hunger very like one he had felt. She told the moveless, silent face all about the folks back east, and second grade, and the time Prod had come courting in his boss's Model T, and him not even knowing how to drive it yet. She told him all the little things that would never be altogether in the past for her, the dress she wore to her confirmation, with a bow here and little gores here and here, and the time Grace's husband came home drunk with his Sunday pants all tore and a live pig under his arm, squealing to wake the dead. She read to him from the prayer book and told him Bible stories. She chattered out everything that was in her mind, except about Jack. He never smiled nor answered, and the only difference it made in him was that he kept his eyes on her face when she was in the room and patiently on the door when she was not. What a profound difference this was. She could not know. But the flat, starved body tissues were not all that were slowly filling out. A day came at last when the prods were at lunch. Dinner, they called it. And there was a fumbling at the inside of the door of Jack's room. Prod exchanged a glance with his wife, then rose and opened it.
"Here now, you can't come out like that," he called. "Ma, throw in my other overalls."
He was weak and very uncertain.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.